Yeah, and to the audience, if you have specific questions during our talk, just raise your hand and then I will come down with the microphone to you. Okay, Mrs. Hof, as NOW is cross-linked with most of the exhibitors here on the fair, can you just shortly introduce the main topics of NOW?
Yes, sure. Well, we're a company which is owned by the German government, and our main task is to manage the federal funding programs for sustainable mobility. So that includes the National Innovation Program, Hydrogen and Fuel Cell Technology, as part of which we fund both research and development as well as acquisition of vehicles. And besides that, we also do a lot of PR just to raise awareness for electric mobility and alternative fuels. We do a bit of consulting for the federal ministries, and we also do a lot of networking via workshops, for example, just to connect the different stakeholders of the industry.
All right, thanks. So it's a wide range of activities. Now, one field, the innovation program. Which amount of funding are we talking about in this program?
Well, we're now in the second phase of the program, which is from 2017 to 2026. And from 2017 to the end of 2019, we have approximately 250 million.
250 million that is available only for German companies or also for companies from other countries?
It doesn't have to be a German company, as long as they have a company placement in Germany and the research is being done in Germany. So it doesn't have to be a German company.
All right. You said that it's also already the second phases. Can you give us some example of successful projects, please?
Well, there are, of course, a lot. We've already done quite a few. The first phase of the program started in 2006, so there have been a lot of projects. Sticking to the topic of today, I would say there are maybe two which are really outstanding. One is the Coradia Island hydrogen train by Alstom, for instance, which is quite a quite a success story, really. The trains are now running in Lower Saxony in Germany, and it's really quite successful. Then we also have a project, for instance, for the development of hydrogen garbage trucks, which is quite an interesting project. And I know that a lot of people are already really interested in actually buying these trucks once they're finished.
I can imagine. Okay, then let's just get into the topic and talk about the role of hydrogen in the mobility sector. Reducing emissions is one of the main aims of the mobility and fuel cell strategy. And where are we standing right now?
Well, it depends. And in heavy duty, we don't really have any vehicles available on the market yet. There are quite a few international developments. Hyundai, for example, is delivering 1,000 hydrogen trucks to Switzerland in the next years. The American company Nikola Motors is producing or developing at the moment a fuel cell truck for the European market as well. So there are definitely quite a few developments. We do have some projects in the pipeline from German actors as well, which I'm not allowed to talk about yet, unfortunately. But there are definitely things coming, but it won't be tomorrow. So there will still be some years until we will actually see some truck, like fuel cell truck fleets on the roads in Germany.
So the reduction potential is really, really high, and we are preparing the projects now to start on that.
Yes, we definitely see a really, really high potential, especially in heavy duty for fuel cells. And since we actually expect the amount of traffic in heavy duty, especially, to even increase in the next few years, I think that the potential for fuel cells in heavy duty is really quite significant.
Maybe a number on that. In Germany, every year, 50 million tons of fuels are consumed in the transport sector every year. What would you think the midterm perspective? How high is the reduction potential with hydrogen, let's say, the next 10 to 15 years?
I think it's really, really difficult to say because we don't really know when vehicles will actually be available on the market and how many, and how much the transport on the road is actually going to increase, or if we will actually see a shift in goods transport towards rail a bit more. So it's really difficult to say. But since hydrogen is a zero emission technology, like locally zero emission, the potentials are, of course, quite big, but it's hard to say in the next few years.
Okay, so let's change the topic into the public transport. So there you already mentioned there are some very successful examples. In which cities, for example, buses are already run by hydrogen?
Buses, we see a lot of activity in Western Germany, in the federal state of North Rhine-Westphalia, for example. The cities Cologne and Wuppertal, of course, they are already purchasing fuel cell buses on bigger fleets. So in Cologne, for instance, it's going to be 30. And the first buses are going to be in operation probably by the mid of this year.
And do you also do some information exchange with other countries or in whole of Germany? Are other players copying these concepts that are already working in Lower Saxony with the trains and, like you mentioned before, the buses in Rhein?
Well, concerning buses, there's a lot going on in Europe. There's the hydrogen and fuel cell joint undertaking by the EU. And they have a funding program which is called JIVE, as part of which fuel cell buses are being purchased in entire Europe at the moment. And for trains, I think Germany is the first country which already has hydrogen trains running. But Alstom, for instance, is currently developing hydrogen trains for Great Britain and France as well. Then there's Siemens, who are developing a hydrogen, like a modular fuel cell battery train. And the Swiss company Stadler is developing hydrogen trains. So there's really a lot of development when it comes to trains.
Okay, now you said we have successful stories, but also some challenges maybe. Which barriers still have to be broken down to have a significant market growth for this sectors?
Well, one point, of course, is investment costs. I'm not going to lie, the hydrogen and fuel cell buses and trains are still significantly more expensive than diesel vehicles, of course, which is why we have that funding. And so we really need to reach a serial production to have these costs go down. When it comes to trains, it's not really that much about technical or safety issues. It's also about some legal issues when it comes to the tendering procedures. Who's responsible for that? Who has to pay for the infrastructure? Do you do like a full service contract where the train producer provides the infrastructure as well? All of these issues. So we don't really have standard procedures for these kind of things. Also when it comes to the approval of the refueling stations.
So the topic is still kind of new on several levels with organizing. The technology is proven, but organizing all the stuff and the legal framework has still to be a little bit worked on. Now, you said the investment costs are more expensive. What about the fuel? Is this hydrogen much cheaper than the fuels out of coal, of oil? And how is that the point?
It really depends on how you produce your hydrogen, where you get it from. If you really want to go for 100% green hydrogen, which is, of course, the goal on a long term, then it can still be quite expensive. If you have to pay all the levies, like in Germany we have the EEG levy, for instance, if you have to pay all of that, then it's still quite expensive. If you can find a way not having to pay these levies, it can get really cheap. Also, if you just use byproduct hydrogen or just product like hydrogen from industries, then it can get really, really cheap. And it actually has the potential to be cheaper in its total cost of ownership on a long term.
On a long term, okay. And do you think a tax, for example, on carbon dioxide emissions could be necessary to expedite electric driving?
I'm not sure if it has to be a tax. I'm not really an expert when it comes to these economic things, I would say. But I think we should definitely introduce some sort of tool, and we need more incentives for the operators to switch to zero emission technologies. Yes.
Okay. We also heard that in the public, the people, they are not the technology is not so known already. Which challenge would you think is bigger, to change the system and how we understand mobility, or to develop market available technology?
I think it's really a combination of both. I think if we really want to switch to electric mobility with both battery and fuel cells, we kind of need to change our habits as well, especially when it comes to road transport. But of course, it's not easy to get people to actually do that. So I think we definitely need that technology development. And I think it's also really important not to look about if it's going to be battery, if it's going to fuel cell. I think we really need to stop thinking about that. We need to develop both technologies. We need to be technology open. And I would really like to see a bit more activity from the German stakeholders as well when it comes to this.
Okay, we have enough time for questions. If you have any, just raise your hand. Okay, now looking to our listeners here, for whom of them the innovation program is in line for new projects? I mean, the funding period is still working, right?
Yes, for R&D projects, it's basically possible to just contact us at any time. We have a funding guideline open, which is all the time open. So it doesn't matter if you're from the industry, if you're a vehicle producer, or if you're a research institute, you can basically contact us at any time with a project idea. For vehicle acquisition, we work with certain calls. So we will have a call probably at the end of this year, for example, for buses. And then we will put out a call, and then you can actually apply for the funding for fuel cell buses. And for a certain amount of vehicles, you can actually also get the infrastructure as well as an on-site electrolyzer funded. Mm.
And for the first appointment with applicants, are there some basic questions that you would ask first?
Not really. I mean, for us, it's always important that the R&D project that we fund actually lead to a development of the technology. So we want to see vehicles on the road at some stage because, like I said, the technology is really ready. We need more vehicles so that costs go down. So this is always an important issue, but really just contact us. Also, if you're just a supplier and you want to get more contacts in the industry.
And one thing that we were not talking about yet is, of course, for transport and for mobility, the refueling stations are very important. And you're also funding the building of refueling stations, when I understand it right?
Yes, for road transport, for just automobiles, we have approximately 60, I think it's exactly 60 refueling stations in Germany at the moment. For buses, we usually not a public refueling station, but a private one just for the operators because they usually like to have their own refueling stations right at the spot where they actually park their vehicles. So we can do that as well. For trains, it's similar. Yes, I think for heavy duty, we really need to think about developing a public infrastructure in Germany. And we are actually now working on getting all the vehicle producers and infrastructure producers together to think about how we can actually roll out a heavy duty hydrogen infrastructure in Germany as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so when the first heavy-duty vehicle comes to the market, would that be the right time now, so the next maybe 2 years, for a transport company to invest in this hydrogen transport fleet? So do we have then also enough refueling stations? What do you think?
Well, when it comes to heavy-duty, I think we will see some first pilot projects. For which it might even be possible to do something like a mobile infrastructure just to begin with. So we will not do like a big rollout for heavy-duty infrastructure before we have vehicles. I think this is something that needs to develop hand in hand. Mm. And so I think it's really the time to invest in hydrogen at the moment if we want to see a rollout of the technology soon. Of course, for operators, there are simply no vehicles available at the moment. But it's definitely a good idea to get in touch with the producers just to communicate your interest and communicate that you might be interested in a pilot project, for instance.
And for such a pilot project, do you already have applications on your desk? Or maybe do you need some applicants here from the audience that take this idea and bring it to you?
We do have some, but it's always good to get more.
Okay, in which area they will be? Can you say something about that? More in the south of it's Germany now, no? More in the south or in the north of Germany? Do you know?
There's definitely a lot going on in northern Germany, yes. But not limited to northern Germany, no.
All right, okay. Yeah, maybe if there is no question in the audience, one question here, okay. Could you announce yourself, please, first, and then ask the question?
Sure, Antonio Parra from Grupo Bimbo. So we do a lot of transportation globally, and we're very interested. We're actually producing our own electric vehicles and very interested in hydrogen vehicles as well. So what would you say is going to be the mix in between electric vehicles and hydrogen vehicles in the year 2050? So that's about 30 years from now.
In heavy duty or in?
Heavy duty.
In heavy duty, I have to say I see a clear potential for fuel cells, just because at least for long distance trucks, because if you want to reach a certain range and you need you would have to build a really, really heavy battery in that vehicle to reach that range. So I really think that there's going to be hydrogen for long distance. For short distance trucks, like within cities, there might be battery as well. And for smaller vehicles, but when we think about long distance trucks, like the 40-ton trucks, I think it's definitely going to be fuel cells.
And what about the topic range extender? Maybe some buses are already going with hydrogen as range extenders. Is this a topic too?
Yes, for buses, definitely we think that the trend is really going towards range extenders, because a lot of operators are doing fine with battery buses, but for many it's just not possible, because the topography is just a bit more difficult, or you need bigger ranges. So then range extender can be very interesting, but you of course also have to think about that you will have to implement two infrastructures, both hydrogen and recharging infrastructure. So you really have to calculate it for yourself, which is cheaper in the end. And for trains, we actually see a development of, for example, the Siemens project, who are developing a battery fuel cell modular system. So depending on the customer demands, the battery system can be bigger, or the fuel cell system can be bigger. So we definitely see a trend towards a combination of both. Mm.
So the combination also maybe depends on the use cases itself, which car or which bus or which train, how far is it going, and yeah, like this. So with this, we already have a small vision I have a small lookout for the next years. Thank you for this interesting interview, Mrs. Hof. It was good to have you here, and I wish you all the best for the next days here at the booth.
Yep, thank you very much.